This video talks about analog comparators. Although the basic operational amplificator can be used as a voltage comparator in some less demanding low-frequency application, we will discuss of a high-performance comparator where propagation delay and sensitivity are important. We will analyze each comparator stage in the clearest and simplest way possible. A voltage comparator is a decision-making circuit. If the V plus input is greater than the V minus input, the output is at a logic 1. If the V plus input is less than V minus input, the output is a logic 0. It is clear that such circuit has numerous applications. Here we briefly mention some examples. When a comparator performs the function of telling if an input voltage is above or below a given threshold, it is essentially performing a 1-bit quantization. This function is used in nearly all the analog-to-digital converters in combination with other devices to achieve a multi-bit quantization. Application examples of high-performance analog comparators are oscilloscope and digital analyzers. Now, let's see the block diagram of a high-performance voltage comparator. We see three stages. The first stage amplifies the input signals to improve the comparator sensitivity, or, in other words, it increases the minimum input signal with which the comparator can make a decision. The second is the decision-making circuit, which has to determine which of the input signals is larger. The third stage is the output buffer, which amplifies the information of the previous stage and outputs a digital signal. The preamplification stage is basically a differential amplifier with active load. So if V plus is different from V minus, the currents in the two branches are these, and they are mirrored in this portion of the circuit. IO plus is this, where GM is the transconductance of M1 and M2, assuming they matched. So, the difference in the input voltages is amplified and turned in a current through the transconductance GM, which sets the gain of the stage. GM depends on the tail current ISS and on the MOSFET M1 and the M2 parameters. In particular, it depends on the ratio W over L, which is important for the input capacitance too. So, the sizes of M1 and M2 are set by considering the diff amp transconductance and the input capacitance, and since we concentrate also on speed, we set the minimum length of the channel MOSFET. In our example, this is related to the process CN20 NMOS, and the minimum length is 2 micrometer. With this process and the numbers you see in the schematic, the beta is 250 microampere over volt square, and GM is 71 microamp over volt. This means that if the differential input is 10 millivolt, we have that the current IO plus is 10.35 microamp and the current IO minus is 9.65 microamp. So the gain of the stage is given by the transconductance GM, but also by the mirror load. Because making larger M4, M3 in respect to M41 and M31, we can increase the gain of the stage. I leave you in the description a video about current mirrors. The decision circuit is the heart of the comparator and should be capable of discriminating millivolt level signals. We should also be able to design the circuit with some hysteresis for use in rejecting noise on a signal. Let me explain better the hysteresis thing. We know that if V plus is larger than V minus, the output is at high value, and if V minus is larger than V plus, then the output is at low value. But what if V plus and V minus are close and there is some noise? For example, let's say that V plus is this stable signal and V minus is this noisy signal. You see that in average V minus is larger than V plus, but it becomes lower many times because of the noise. The output will be this, in which you see many switches from low to high, and this is bad. We prefer keeping into consideration the noise and create some hysteresis. So we want the switch from low to high occurring only when V minus minus V plus is less than VSPL, and the switch from high to low occurring only when V plus minus V minus is more than VSPH. So we have two thresholds and not one. In this case, the output would be this, because when the signals are in the hysteresis range, nothing happens and we keep the last value, which is a low output voltage in our case. The working with hysteresis is this, where you can see we get a clear output. Of course, we have to set the hysteresis properly, keeping in mind the noise. Now, let's begin by assuming that IO plus is much larger than IO minus, so that M5 and M7 are on and M6 and M8 are off. We will also assume that beta 5 equals beta 8 equals beta A, and beta 6 equals beta 7 equals beta B. Under these circumstances, VO minus is approximately 0 volt, and for calculating VO plus, we see that M5 is in saturation mode, so its current is this, and it is equal to IO plus because M6 is off. From this relation we get this formula for VO plus. So in this situation the wall IO plus goes through M5 and the wall IO minus goes through M7. If we start to increase IO minus and decrease IO plus, the switching takes place when the drain source voltages of M7 is equal to V threshold of M6. At this point M6 starts to take current away from M5. This decreases the drain current voltage of M5, thus starting to turn off M7 off. If we assume that the maximum value of VO plus or VO minus is equal to 2V threshold, then M6 and M7 operate in either cutoff and triode regions. Keeping increasing IO minus, VO minus voltage increases and M6 is always more on, going in triode region, so the drain of M6 goes to zero, switching off M5 and M7. At the same time, increasing VO minus switches on M8, which takes the wall IO minus current. So the currents flow in this way. You see that M5 and M8 work as positive feedback because they help the switching. But before turning off, M7 reaches the V threshold of M6, where switching point occurs, and at this point M7 operates in saturation region, and its current is this. From these relations, we get this equation, which ties the two currents to the ratio of the betas. This is important because this is the point in which the switching takes place, when M6 is turning off and M7 is turning on. If the beta A and beta B are equal, the switching occurs when IO plus is equal to IO minus, but if beta A is different from beta B, we have hysteresis. In order to find the hysteresis voltage VSPH, we remember IO plus as function of the differential input, and we remember that in the differential amplifier the sum of the currents in the two branches is always equal to the tail current ISS. From these equations we get this, which we can rewrite in this way, and so in this. From this last equation we obtain the VSPH value and so the VSPL. So, depending on the noise of the input signal, we get the hysteresis threshold to get a clear output. For example, by setting beta A equals beta B equals this and holding the V minus at 2.5 volts and sweeping V plus from 2 to 3 volts, we get this behavior in which you see that the switching point is only 1 at 2.5 volts when VO plus is equal to VO minus. If we make, for example, beta B larger than beta A, we create an hysteresis index example of 40 mV, and in this case the switching occurs when V plus is above V minus of 40 mV. Here you see what happens if we hold V minus to 2.5 volts and we sweep V plus from 2.4 to 2.6 volts. As you can see, VO minus is equal to VO plus when V plus is 40 mV above V minus, so when V plus is 2.54 volts. A similar behavior can be shown for VSPL, which is at 2.46 volts. The final component in our comparator design is the output buffer. The main purpose of the output buffer is to convert the output of the decision circuit into a logic signal, 0 volt or 5 volt. The circuit is a self-biasing differential amplifier. An inverter was added on the output of the amplifier as an additional gain stage, and to isolate any load capacitance from the self-biasing differential amplifier. Now let's say how the circuit works. Let's say that VO plus is at high voltage and VO minus is at zero, so that M14 and M10 are on and M11 and M13 are off. In this case, M12 is on, and being M14 on, we have a zero in the input of the final inverter, so that Vout is at 5 volt. The case of VO minus greater than VO plus, thus we get zero on the output as we wanted. Here we see a simulation in which we sweep VO minus from 1 to 4 volts and we increase VO plus from 1 to 3.5 volts through steps of 0.5 volts increments. As you see, for linear operation of the output buffer, the input has to be between 1.5 volts and 3 volts. Comparing this result with the output of the decision circuit, we see a problem because it swings from 0 to 2 times V thresholds, or more or less 1.5 volts. For this reason, we have to add the M17 transistor to shift the output of the decision circuit up of approximately 1 volt. So here we have the final circuit where the MOSFET M17 is added in series with the decision circuit to increase the average voltage out of the decision circuit. With V minus held to 2.5 volts and V plus swept from 2.49 to 2.51 volts, we see the output voltage with highlighted the offset voltage of about 1 millivolt. The input offset voltage is defined as the voltage that must be applied between the two input terminals of the differential amplifier to obtain 0 volts at the output. If we take the derivative of this curve, we get the gain of the whole circuit, which is 2000. Considering the output range between 0 and 5 volts, it means that approximately 2.5 millivolts is needed to make the comparator output change logic levels. The comparator gain can be increased by increasing the transconductance of the preamp, that is, by increasing the widths of M1 and M2, or by adding additional inverters. The simulated transient response of the comparator is shown here. We consider V minus equal to 0.5 volt DC and we give the V plus input a 10 nanosecond wide pulse with an amplitude varying from 2.49 to 2.51 volts. This is termed a narrow pulse with a 10 millivolt overdrive. We are driving the plus input of the comparator 10 millivolt over the negative input. On the right, you see the response, and if the pulse amplitude or width is reduced much beyond this level, the comparator does not make a full transition. You see also that the delay of the comparator is approximately 10 nanoseconds, and this should be compared with the delay of an op-amp used as a comparator, which may be several hundred nanoseconds. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.